this is part of it. We have heard already yesterday a lot of these things, so I don't go into too much details. Of course, we have the UN space treaties and we have the ITU legal framework, mainly the radio regulations. National law is the means to implement these international legal vehicles and also to ensure compliance on the national level. However, if you look to small satellites, there are a number of issues. The first is there any national space legislation in place? And the answer is only a very limited number of states has enacted national space legislation. It's around 20 of around 200, so only around 10%. Are small satellites in the scope of national space legislation? Yeah. Some of the very few legislations refer to operation and guidance of a space project or effective control of a space project. The latter is the case in Belgium, the first in the Netherlands. Yeah. So very questionable whether the existing law covers small satellites, at least not a big number of them. Yeah. Are there specific rules on small satellites? Yeah. Again, yeah, out of the already small number, very, very small number of existing space legislation has such specific rules. Yeah? And if so, not even covering all of them, because some of these laws mention only satellites for educational purpose. So they would not cover small satellites for commercial purpose. Yeah? Are the licensing and other requirements, and mainly we heard already yesterday, insurance on insurance obligations, for example, or also more technical instructions for operations, are they appropriate for small satellites? And again, the answer is not always. Yeah? Some requirements cannot even be objectively complied with. Yeah? And then last but not least, yeah, even if you would in your state have national space legislation in place, and even with specific provisions for small satellites, and still there's an apparent problem that currently many projects are not on the radar of the competent authorities. They simply go below, so no awareness, so you cannot ensure compliance. Some more details on the state of play in national space legislation. Yeah, first of all, Belgium. Yeah. Belgium has a space law since, I think, 2007 or so. As I just mentioned on the previous slide, it refers to effective operation, but the Belgian government now interprets this term operator bit more broadly, so to cover also small satellites. In the Netherlands, and we heard it also yesterday, the national space legislation in place does not apply to small satellites as it is, and therefore these projects are currently not really authorized, supervised. However, the Netherlands is working on an amendment to the law, and probably quite soon this will change. Yeah? Some states already adopted special provisions in the national space legislation for small satellites, namely regarding financial responsibilities and licensing requirements for space activities for educational purposes. This is the case in only two countries, Austria and Australia. Yeah? But some states are already following. Netherlands is already mentioned, but also the UK, as we also heard yesterday, is considering amendments to the national space legislation, namely on the obligations to take out third-party liability insurance. In any case, if you look to the future, amendments to the law take a long time. Yeah? Even on the national level, they might take 3 years, 4 years, 5 years. And if we look to the international level, we heard yesterday morning in one of the first presentations how the ITU works and how long it can take. Sometimes the period of at least two WRCs, so 8 years, sometimes more. So it's a long process, and for international space law, we don't even speak about it. Yeah? So the question is what to do in the few until we would reach status with more adopted legislative provisions. Yeah? But okay, one more thought on this. Yeah, even if you don't, if you have these type of provisions in the national law, then still this does not guarantee per se that licensing authorities on the one side are aware of small satellite projects, and vice versa, yeah, that entities undertaking small satellite projects are aware of the licensing requirements. Yeah? So, in the absence of specific laws and regulations, yeah, how can we ensure compliance? And this was the introduction. Yeah? The first aspect is ensure compliance through procurement conditions. This is maybe not so much the right solution just for today, where we are today. But it might change already in the next future. We have some companies here already offering commercial services with small satellites. And of course, public authorities all over the world might procure these services, Earth observation data, Earth observation services, and so on. And then yeah, the procurement law and the procurement procedure gives you a means, a potential means to ensure compliance. And this is quite simple. You just write it in the ITT. Yeah? and this is, in fact, can be done by more generic procurement conditions, as we see on the next slide, or by very specific procurement condition. And this is not a big legal issue. Yeah? It can be done, one example here already mentioned, yeah? From the International Labour Organization. Yeah? And then, of course, if you include it in the procurement procedure and the procurement condition, then in the end, if the contract is awarded, then it's also reflected in the contractual provisions. Yeah? I have just taken here ESA as an example how this could work. Yeah? It was more by chance, but in fact, it's quite a good coincidence having heard the presentation of the ESA Educational Department yesterday. Yeah? So ESA has, in fact, general conditions of tender. Yeah? They are always forming integral part of each ITT. And then there are special conditions of tender, and they can be designed to the specific needs, circumstances of the project. And then part of the ITT, there's also always a draft contract, mostly quite generic, but it could be also already including one or two specific provisions. That does not cost a lot of time. Yeah? Okay, but as I said, this is maybe not an immediate solution because we are not yet in a state where public entities are procuring to a visible number of projects, services, data from small satellites. So it's more for tomorrow. But much more evident already today is ensuring compliance to grant conditions. And that's why most of the projects, in some way or the other, they receive public funding. Yeah? And public funding is given by grant procedures and on the basis of resulting grant agreements. So again, we are in a legal contractual world where we might receive some help. Yeah? There are, of course, a number of grant projects on the national level, on ESA level, NASA, national space agencies, and also the quite famous EU framework research program now called Horizon 2020 in its latest period. Yeah? And here again, yeah, more or less the same functioning as we have just seen for procurement. We have, first of all, we have the grant conditions and we have the resulting grant agreement. Yeah? Again, yeah, we can just include specific provisions in both the grant conditions and the grant agreements. Yeah? This is a slide I can be just short. Yeah? In fact, there is always a choice between more generic legal provisions and already very specific provisions. The more generic ones, they simply refer to the applicable law and demand either the contractor or the beneficiary, other in case of grants, to comply with the applicable national and international law. If you want to be more specific, then of course you make hints to the applicable national space legislation, to the national telecommunications laws and regulations, to the ITU radio regulations, and so on and so on. So you have the choice between quite a short and generic provision and much more detailed things. Yeah? But in any case, it's quite easy because it takes a lawyer a few hours to develop these clauses. Then you include it in the ITT or in the announcement of opportunity, and that's it. Nevertheless, and we heard it many, many times, yeah, just writing it contract conditions, procurement grant conditions, and requesting compliance is not enough. Yeah. Therefore, these type of measures, they should be accompanied by additional, more supportive measures, creating awareness, helping to fill out the forms, to run through the procedures, and so on. And as we heard many times, this is really necessary. Here, we wrote this without knowing what Attila announced yesterday, that there will be soon a handbook issued by ITU with the OOSA together. So that's for me a great news. And should be very helpful. We also heard that ESA has developed certain short papers on the registration on the one side and on the frequency part on the other side. And from my perspective, this should be really a best practice also for other national space agencies around the world. Of course, these type of documents, they can be even supported by more measures like specific training, website with information and links to the competent authorities, and of course, yeah, if the number of projects in a specific country is high, then you could even think of support teams in the space agency or with the telecom regulator and information days like the one we are here. There are probably other measures, but these should be the core. And so the more contractual measures should be added by these supporting measures. And then we can reach already probably a little bit of more compliance in the absence of specific laws. And that's just the conclusions, what I summarized. That's the summary. So thank you very much.
Great, Ingo. Thank you very much, and I'm happy to hear and see that you are also ready to support the small satellites. It's not only the big multi-billion international projects, but also you are ready to support.
Well, in fact, some national regulators, they have provisions when you get grants for your project, you can even include some legal support costs in your project costs, but that needs to be checked in the individual case. But I heard it at least one or two times. So.
Good. Thank you very much. Okay. Next speaker is a nice example of young student, radio amateur, becoming a project manager of Delphi C3, and I can say fully following ITU radio regulation, API, notification, like in the big book. After successful managing of this project, he became an owner of ISIS, and now he's a RF system engineer, and he is the working party 7B drafting group